First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Back once again with Dr. Alain Bey. Tonight's show is basically higher and lower magic, the Akashi Records and the spirit communication. What we're going to do is get into some of this information on the science of high magic and low magic. When we actually look at that science, you have to understand that it's the greater and the lesser mysteries. I give you a good example. In high magic, ultimately, it's designed to change the person, thus altering the manifest reality. It involves the science of alchemy. So high magic does not typically manifest things per se. It manifests changes within one's own inner reality and thus change the outer apparent reality. All right, I'll give you a good example. Shechem, who's known as Raoul Nefer Amen, stated that if you're not cultivating and manifesting the unifying self-image of the Godhead within you, but instead you're cultivating and manifesting your persona, then you are a worshiper of a demigod in the nonsense of Western theology or theologians. All right? What I say is that if you're worshiping something outside of yourself, then you are an idol worshiper. Hence, an antichrist, for only the body is the temple of God, or Christ, or the Holy Spirit. You know, if you talk about it from a Christian perspective. All right, now when you get the low magic, it's designed to change the apparent reality, the illusion, the matrix, the mind, you know, through multiple methods. Typically, a low magical working attempts to overpower the existing manifestations and thus make the desired manifestation happen. It's like a jamming a radio or a TV station so that you can put your own signal on top of it. That's basically what it does. So low magic can be quite effective. But since it's usually only overpowered that normal manifestation or manifest reality, it is only at best temporary. So remember, everything in the personality already is against the desired manifestation otherwise. It would exist without the need for additional work. and understand what we just said on that. For example, the establishment schools, churches are under the control of the government via the Rockefeller clan and does not want you to study these so-called pseudosciences. All right? For example, metaphysics been around since the ancient mystery schools for thousands and thousands of years. But when science get a hold to it, it's changed the name from metaphysics to quantum physics. So they don't want you to study these particular sciences, astrotheology, mythology or numerology, the tarot, because these are so-called sciences that actually can tell you, these are tools, however, and they tell you that these particular tools are of the devil or that they're taboo or that they're of the occult. And of course, the word occult simply means within Latin hidden, but this is what they'll tell you, So religion has humanity looking for God in the sky or outside somewhere outside of themselves. And instead of teaching humanity the highest truths, the system lies and seemingly refuses to tell people that God, or as we refer to as Jesus Christ or Holy Spirit, all dwells within each and every one of us. So this is the problem which that is going on. So this is the difference between higher magic and low magic, or high magic and low magic. All right. One attempts to cultivate self, which is high magic, and low magic attempts to jam the apparent reality with its own frequency, because thought is the manifestation of everything in existence. Matter of fact, that's the first principle of Tawhidi, is mentalism. The all is mind and everything in the universe is mental. So if there's something in which that you don't like, in which that is going on, you can actually utilize your own magic, your own power of thought, because the magic wand is actually your mind, in order to jam what is going on, because there's always alternative or alternating parallel timelines. In other words, when you see a particular timeline happening, and if you don't like it, you can change it. But by doing so, sometimes you might wreak the karmic effect. All right? So you have to be pure of heart, pure of mind when you do so, as much as possible, so that the energies won't come back on you later. And, because sometimes it can act like a tidal wave in a sense. You might be holding it back like with a dam, but if the power of a tsunami comes, then that dam is going to break, and I'm just talking about that figuratively, the thing is about low magic is that you have to conduct it properly, all right? And so when you look at the greater and lesser mysteries, you have to look at particular things such as the word spirit. The word spirit comes from the Latin word espirito, which means to breathe. In the greater mysteries, that's what you taught it, which is based on the esoteric, the inner teachings, the inner sciences, how to tap into that internal power. In the lesser mysteries, you taught esoteric information. Like, for example, history, geography, astronomy, mathematics. These types of things are taught within the lesser mysteries or exoteric mysteries. But they show you the correlation of strength throughout all of those particular schools of thoughts and show you how it ties back into the internal mysteries and how it applies back to the physical body, which is the greater mystery. It is also known as the golden key and the silver key. And this is spoken of within the greater keys of Solomon and the lesser keys of, and the lesser keys of King Solomon. And both of those, it speaks about these particular sciences and how King Solomon used the Shiloh Dawid, or the Star of David, as it was called, the Mogan Star of David, in which that was utilized in order to capture entities, spirits, demons, as we were saying. And he was able to utilize them demons for his own works. That is something in which that can be utilized or can be done, but only after you have developed your subtle bodies to an extent. You can't do that starting out and just being curious. This isn't about curiosity, because after you can become demonically possessed, playing around with these type of forces, if you're not ready yet. What I recommend is that you learn these particular sciences in which that develops the subtle body, Qigong or Tai Chi. That's why these sciences here are yoga, all eight forms of yoga, everything from Hatha yoga to Tantra. This is what is needed in order to develop those subtle bodies. And it's only at that point in which that you reach those particular levels. Now, when you get into setting up, also another thing that I want to talk about is setting up your altar. Because a lot of people are trying to invoke entities and deities and don't even have an altar or a shrine set up. But when you do it, it has to be based on the seven elements. You know, some say four elements, but it's actually seven. You know, earth, you know, which that, you know, can deal with food, shells, crystals, or gems, or magnets, or coins can be on the altar. Symbolizes the elements of earth. Of course, water, a glass of water, libations, or liquor, alcohol. Fire, and what that does basically with the lighting up the candle or the lighting of the incense. The incense also deals with the air aspect. The power of sound is also implemented. You can basically use your voice. And what you want to do is you can speak the words in your mind, whisper it, and then finally make it audible out loud. You can do drums, bells, flutes, other musical instruments may be used. And let me say this too, that when you're talking about the water or the libations, in particular, you're going to use liquor, gin, vodka, or rum, you know, the spirits or liquor itself, you know, they can use a small quantity, especially for those ancestors that may have had a drinking problem. Okay? You don't want Uncle Johnny flipping on you and shit, you know, because if he flipped on you here, and he definitely flipped, you know what I'm saying, change. You know what I'm saying? Same attitude and everything, even after you leave the physical body. All right? Then, of course, you have the element of light, which that correlates to you probably attuning your third eye to the first eye, and which that gives you strength in your auric field. And then, of course, you have the thought element. And as you say, you want to make, you want to be able to speak these particular affirmations, decrees, prayers, whatever inside your mind first, you know, and then you want, you know, put intentions and affirmations, which is your prayers and decrees, plus frequency, you know, something in which that is repeated often, you know, and it's actually felt at the core of your being, you know, is what manifests into existence. and this correlates to the science of candle magic, you know. You know, for example, the magi would concentrate on a problem or a question, and then stare, you know, or hold the candle in their hand, and, you know, and say what they need to say, concentrating as hard as they possibly can. And the auric residue in which that you leave upon the candle is what the candle will burn towards, because that auric residue, your energy is left upon that. So that means that it's like you left or impended upon that candle the last thoughts. All right, or you can also use a mirror and stare into the mirror, you know, and from, you know, from there you might receive a vision and what you're able to interpret. You know, I know we use the do mirror magic, in which that at a point you actually will blank out from seeing yourself, and another image will appear. Normally it would be your higher self if that's what you're concentrating towards. And sometimes your higher self doesn't look quite like you. Might be mean looking. This is where the whole science of Set and Heru. If you ever seen Set and Heru, you see Set at the back of the neck, or near the medulla oblongata coming out after the head of Heru, because it's in that location in which that give you access to lucid dreams or visions. Okay? So this is some of the sciences. The medulla oblongata is that area in which that helps with that process. And some people are playing with things that they don't really understand as of yet. You know, like, for example, you read the Khan Protocol, Remembering the Traditions of Our Ancestors, by Nana Akua Opokua. This is what he says. He says that the ancestral altar allows us to establish the communication with our personal ancestors in a real way. We can touch the altar, hence, remember, for a left hemisphere person who's linear, they need something tangible, because their mind hasn't made the transition to the right hemisphere in which that deals with the abstract. You know, but if you keep doing it enough, you open a passageway from the left to the right hemisphere, and you'll feel the presence of the ancestors while you sit there and talk there. You know, it is our way of, you know, connecting with the ancestors, and they can help us. You know, deceased relatives and constructed altars in the homes contain, you want to contain photographs of those ancestors. Dozen times a celebration of crisis, a person can offer thanks or call on his or her ancestors for guidance, help, or blessings, you know, or bliss, as we would rather say. You know, with blessings, these were blood sacrifices, based on the definition, old definition, that is. It also now come to mean favor of God. So we will refer to it in that particular meaning. Of course, you have to connotative, and you have the deconnotative meaning of these particular words. All right? So people that are connected to the ancestors, you know, the third eye must be focused to the first eye to receive the messages from the spirit world about life choices. But you do not have to make any decisions without first being properly guided. Then you never feel alone. You know, therefore, you know, there's less likely to be sad, you know, for you to be sad or to be depressed. You get along better with your living family members, you know. And you're protected, you know, better against strangers and those with harmful intentions. When you acknowledge your ancestors, be sure to call upon the seven generations on your mother's side and the seven generations on your father's side, because that's what you're concentration on. You know, the critical factor in anyone's life is the degree to which that the personality or the ego defines the spiritual reality and strives towards unification with the higher self. which is hence the soul. Unfortunately, you know, education, especially nowadays, forces young minds strictly towards material goals, thereby divorcing instruction on true religion or spirituality for the educational, from the educational curriculum. And religion is simply degraded spiritual systems that is derived from the oldest findings, which comes from out of Kush, you know, or Ethiopia area, you know, what is known now known as Tanzania, Kenya, you know, where Uganda, where they say that the first man appeared from out of that particular area. At least that's where the oldest bones have been found. It's within South Africa, however, where the oldest relics or artifacts have been found, actually, is in South Africa, in which that dates back 2.8 billion years ago. If you get the book called Forbidden Archaeology, The Hidden History of the Human Race by Michael Creedmore and Richardson Thompson L. Richardson L. Thompson, excuse me, you'll see in there what they're talking about. So, that's just some things, you know, to think about right quick. You know, you can say something like, I give thanks to all the living earth gods, goddesses, and the high praise to the living ethereal gods and goddesses, you know, in honor of the previous mentioned transition of past or those who passed on. Of course, we know that the title ancestors is reserved for the deceased that were held in high regard while living on earth. You know, in apparent death, these beings are trusted to provide support and protection for those invoking the spirits. Right? Matter of fact, this is their witness to even in your Bible, Romans 8, chapter 14 through the 16, 17 verse, which says, for as many as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons and daughters of God. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if God, then heirs of God and joint heirs of Christ. And so be it, then we suffer with him that we may be also glorified together. So that's what this is all symbolic to as far as the connection between humanity and ancestors. Therefore, the evolved ancestors are joint heirs, you know, and act as the mediators between man and God. All right? That's a way in order to look at it too. So, like, for example, for a person who's righteous, someone who dies at an old age from natural causes is held in a high regard. Or someone that dies apparently in war from a just cause. Or someone who has high respect that follows a defined moral code or passes on the ethnic code of their family elders, from their family elders and ancestors before them. Someone that had children during their lifetime. An exception is occasionally made for those that are barren in life, that they would, based off of it, if they did some exceptional, you know, from their community or family. Anyone who serves as a link between the living material world and the spiritual worlds, you know, such as priests, mediums, psychics, magicians, artists, etc. You know, ancestors are known to do the following, you know, basically act as a mediator between man and God, like we said, give protection, act on your behalf, fight your enemies, so that you don't have to act except in extreme cases, because there is a time for war and there's a time for peace. Help determine if the person around you are friends or foe, provide perfected insight on matters that have confused you, keep you grounded and connected to the family energy. You know, now, this is for those in which that might not be considered ancestors, but dead relatives. You know, for example, you know, some unrighteous things, like for a person who that might have committed suicide. This is what it's been within African culture now, African religions. Criminals, thieves, murderers, liars, etc. General non-repentive sociopaths, psychopathic poor characters, promiscuous, cowardly, deceitful, etc. young people that die unexpectedly or in tragedies, people that die without children. As like you said, that's a rare exception. You're also rare, above for rare exceptions. People that did not display wisdom or spiritual understanding of life, you know, and of course push back the unworthy. You cannot come to my shrine if you're a pedophile or a molester, you know, or et cetera. You know, so the dead relative of those that are in the afterworld or on the astral plane, probably the lower ones, but receive no honors, you know what I'm saying, like praises, poems, or sacrifices. However, let me say this, is that through your thoughts, you can actually praise a dead relative to the state of an ancestor. Yeah, I have to say that because I know that for a fact, because I did that with my cousin Tim. All right, my cousin Tim, you know, he was robbing nigga houses in Brooklyn. You know what I'm saying? He ended up getting shot. Shot dead. You know, I found out about it, and I threw his picture, you know, back in the days when we was, you know, children. You know, like, we was like around 2, 3, 4 years old. And I threw him up on the altar. You know? Instead of calling his name while I'm pouring libations, I'm calling his name every day, 2, 3, 4 times a day. I'm calling all my ancestors, and I'm adding him into the mix. Well, the ancestors came and took me from out my body. When he was graduating, when he finally moved up from a dead relative to an ancestor state, and they gave him his African garbs, or his garments, I should say. And it was like a soul train line. And all the ancestors was around wearing their garbs. And he was coming down the middle, and he was looking shocked. He was in shock. Like, he didn't know what was going on. But he was being welcomed into the realm of the ancestors instead of just being a dead relative. And you're able to do that by calling on the person, you know, and giving positive thoughts towards them in order to move on towards the higher plane into the ancestral realm. Because normally, a dead relative, they're not consulted, nor are they afforded a direct connection to the Godhead, so that their living relatives can gain direct, you know, divine insight. You know, so these individuals can be prayed for by their still living ancestors, or, you know, relatives actually here on earth to help strengthen them. You know, this is what we're talking about. So that when they reincarnate, you know what I'm saying, they will be able to do more as an evolved being in a better life or environment. Because they would have learned their valuable lessons in the astral world. You know, and learn what they weren't able to learn on earth in that last incarnation. And it helps them to transcend to the higher astral planes. You know, we also say that, once the ancestor has resolved their guilt-ridden issues on the astral plane, the collective ancestors that are called or invoked will allow them into the fold, and that's what happened. You know, Brother Bobby Hemmings stated that when relatives die, they go in you. In other words, the ancestors are your DNA or genes. You know, so that was one of my privileges, you know, of seeing my first cousin, you know, go and become an ancestor. And he couldn't hear me or anything. As a matter of fact, I only thing I can do was watch. That was it. I was trying to talk to him and everything, but the entity or the spirit in which that was with me told me that I could not talk to him. That was only had permission only to see at that particular time. I can only see it take place. And that's probably his best, because he had to be grown by the ancestors in which that was clapping and cheering for him as he came into the fold. But once again, this is my first cousin. We grew up together. You know, so these types of things are actually done, you know what I'm saying, when you're close to a person or in which you have a family connection, bloodline to them. You know, a lot of people like to work with entities in which that they read about, you know, in the storyline. You know, I know one of the brothers that might come on later, hopefully he'll come on, you know, he was trying to tap into the spirit of Lilith. But these are nothing but characters of our own mental psyche that didn't physically exist. And because the people have thought of it as collective, it's produced what is known as a thought form, in which that these entities dwell now on the first and second overtone level, elves, trolls, smurfs, certain alien types, greys, all these entities dwell on the first and second overtone level of their astral plane. But not necessarily existed here on the physical plane at one time. Or may have existed here on the physical plane at one time, but died out based on natural selection. So now their only correspondence is through you and through your mental apparatus, known as your brain. Happening specifically within the medulla oblongata, where your past lives are stored. As well as also, if you scar that particular area, tapping at the back of the head, you can develop what is known as photographic memory. All right. Let's get into the Akashic Records. Get into that science. When you look at the Akashic Records, you actually got to think about certain things. Because Akashic Records mean Akash within Sanskrit means the sky or space or the ethers or aethers. And it's a term used by the Theosophy and the Anthroposophy to describe basically a mystical knowledge that's supposedly encoded in a non-physical plane of existence. So the Akashic Records are described as containing all knowledge of the human experience and the history of the cosmos. Once you have developed yourself to that level, then you need no spiritual assistance, because you can enter into the Akashic Records and channel the information at will. You know, metaphorically, it's been known as the Universal Library, or the universal supercomputer, as you know, now with their modern technology. But the ancients referred to as the mind of God. People who, you know, describe the records assert that they are constantly updating automatically, and that they can be accessible, you know, or gain access through the astral projection, or under some deep hypnosis, or through remote viewing. In ancient Kemet, it was known as the Amenta. It was known as the underworld or the land of the dead. But Amenta do not mean the land of the dead. Nor does it mean necessarily the underworld, which that is talking about in reference to the subconscious. Amenta itself, Amen, means secret or hidden. Ta means earth or land. So it means the hidden land, or the hidden earth. Now, the physical plane or the material plane is the lowest plane of existence. The ancient Gnostics and the Essenes teach that the human body is a prison for the soul. Or in other words, the soul or God is entrapped incarcerated or incarnated, I should say, or imprisoned or imprisoned in the physical body. However, only temporarily. Matter of fact, this is where this jail comes in at. It's based on that principle coming from the Jewish Jewish Talmud and Mishnah. It's how the jail system is put together. That's what's called the penal system, as in the penile gland. Just like the soul is incarcerated inside of the pineal gland, as we would say, which is the seat of the soul. Actually, it's the throne of our soul, or the throne symbolizes our set. Of course, her name, Aset, or Isis, means the throne. And Aset sits on that throne. In the Quran, the second chapter, the 29th verse, it says, it is he who created everything on the earth for you, and then directed his attention up to heaven, and arranged it into seven regular heavens, and he has knowledge of all things. Then he turned to the heavens when it was the smoke. In 2 days, he determined to them as seven heavens and revealed in every heaven his own mandate. This is the Quran, the 41st chapter, the 12th verse. So when you see these words heaven or the seven heavens, it is actually talking about the different atmospheres of the planet. You have the troposphere, which is called the biosphere, which is here. You have the ozone sphere, the stratosphere, the mesosphere, the thermosphere, the ionosphere, which is also called the magnetosphere, and that extends about 30 to 250 miles up. And if you get the book called the UNC, the African Origin of Electromagnetism by Brother Nur Unk Amin, he states that everyone seems to agree that this realm, heaven, is located in the sky above the clouds somewhere, but no one wants to specifically state its exact location. Heaven was in the ionosphere, and the ionosphere is a mirror image of the electromagnetic emissions from the earth. So no matter how faint, the spiritual characteristics of every object on earth is duplicated in heaven, because the electrons there to vibrate in such a way as to emit an exact electronic image of all earth transmissions. Now, this is what it said, and this has to be true because scientists have looked at the electron under the most powerful microscope, and they said that at 360-degree turn, that the electron blinks out and makes another 360-degree turn, obviously, and then comes back into the physical. So what they are saying is that the law of reincarnation makes sense because the electrons does the exact same thing. It comes in to physical sight, makes 360-degree turn, and blinks out and go into some other realm and makes a 360-degree turn from their speculation and then reappears again. All right? The scientist John Carlone proved that the electron had all the properties of the black hole. Plus, it exchanges black photons with other electrons, enabling it to continually accumulate data. This means that if we were to view the electron, the most subtlest of water vapor, as a carrier of memory, it has experienced everything in creation since the very beginning. And that's no coincidence that your body just happened to be 75% to 90% water. What's in between a living person and a dead person? When you come into this world and your nose become unplugged, you take an inhale for the first time. However, as you pass form, you take an exhale. What is being exhaled is the breath of life, Shu, as in Yahshua, which is the Aramaic name for Jesus, hence the meaning of the word spirit. If you look up in Webster's dictionary, the word spirit and breath, they are synonymous. means the same thing. So the spirit, which is the breath, leaves the physical body. And it's water vapor, the most subtlest form of water vapor, in which that we now know, based on the results of the Japanese scientist, Masaru Emoto, that water carries memory. And it actually has over 440,000 channels of memory. So the fact that it experiences everything in creation, and thus the meaning that we don't have a set birth record, explains a whole lot of things. And then the seventh atmosphere is the exosphere, which is the Van Allen belt, in which that anybody who say that the Albion done been to the moon or been to Mars, not physically, because you can't get past the Van Allen belt. Too much radiation. And they don't have melanin to do so. Not a substantial amount of it. And so they risk coming back with cancer, trying to go outside of the Van Allen belt. And this has been actually proven. You know, and we're going to go into it next week when we talk about specifically the moon and Mars hoax. The people falling for if they've gone to the moon or Mars. They haven't escaped past the exosphere, not in the ships in which that they have shown us. This is why they're working on wormholes, those different things, stargates. All right, so these seven heavens, or the seven layers, acts as a prism, or prison, which melanin acts as a black hole, absorbing, conducting, and transforming all sound, electrical, magnetic, light, heat, radiation, waves, and frequencies. All right, ether itself, which is, you know, in classical Greek, is known as the upper atmosphere. So that's also what all of that is talking about, and as a substance filling all space. So it says that traditional, the etheric is described as the innermost of the seven bands around the earth, penetrating deep into the planet and reaching to a certain height in the atmosphere. So this is where the Akashic Records extends to, according to the ancient Hindu philosophy and cosmology. Akasha is, in fact, one of the seven recognized states of matter. You know, whereas, you know, here in the, you know, in the West, we perceive and recognize matter in three forms, solid, liquid, and gases. You know, but we know that it's more than that. As a matter of fact, there's seven worlds. And based on the physical, chemical region, you have the first region of solid, second region of liquid, third region of gas, which is the dense body. You have the etheric region, which deals with chemical ether, life ether, light ether, and reflective or reflecting ether, which is thought ether. And that's the vital body. But then you have the desire world, which deals with the emotional or the astral plane, which is the desire body, in which that is reaching the passions and low desires. It's talking about these particular entities. And you have the region of impressibility. Remember, the first and second overtone of the astral plane, this is where these beings live at. This is called the repulsive. Then the third region is the wishes. Fourth region is dealing with feelings, interests, and indifferences. The fifth region is with the soul life. Sixth soul light, and the seventh soul power, which is with the attraction. And it's all part of the desire world. And you have the world of thought. You have the region of concentrated or concrete thought. The first region is the archetypal form. the archetype of the universal vitality, which is the second, the region of the archetype of desire and emotions, the third, the fourth region contains the archetype force of the human mind. Then you have the region of the abstract thoughts. Now that's dealing with the mind. Now you have the human spirit, which is dealing with the abstract thoughts, which is all both part of the realm of the world of the thoughts. But the fifth is dealing with the ideas of desire and emotions in animal and man, the abode of the third aspect of the spirit and man. The sixth dealing with the idea of life and plants, animal and man. The seventh dealing with the forming minerals, plants, animal, and man. Then you have the world of life spirit, which is the seven regions, which is the abode of the seven aspects of the threefold spirit and man. Then you have the world of divine spirit, consists of seven regions in the abode of the highest spiritual influence in man, which is done with the divine spirit. You have the world of virgin spirits. This world consists of seven regions in the abode of the virgin spirits, which has been differentiated in God before the pilgrimage through matter, which is called the vehicles of man. Then you have the world of God, consisting of seven regions. And these are the seven worlds. All right, this is what this is all talking about. So, of course, the physical plane is where we currently dwell. Out of bodies, the ethereal plane, higher than that is the then the ethereal plane is the lower astral emotion, because that's what the ethereal plane is, the lower astral, the emotional plane, also called the plane of force. The next plane up from the ethereal is the astral plane, the high emotional plane. Above that is the mental plane. We're just saying above, because they all are interconnected. All right? Then you have the causal plane, which is the higher mental, spiritual, and then the soul. The three bodies in which that survives out of the seven bodies of what we refer to as death. The first one, physical, ethereal, astral, and mental, they decompose and become part of the realm of form, and then utilized by other human beings within the process of being able to absorb what is known as prana or chi or ki energy. However, the person who has developed a set of bodies, they can actually survive what we refer to as death. And the three bodies always that survive death is known as the Aku, which is called the glorified light body, the Ba, the Ka. Or the Ka and the Ba, I should say. The Ka is the spirit and the Ba is the soul. Those three bodies survive. It's like an egg, like the shell, the white, and the yellow yolk. As a matter of fact, if you get the acclaimed book, Science of Melanin, by Timothy Owen Moore, he remarks that plasma, or dust and gas, in space carries electromagnetic charges, and that space is an electromagnetic web containing mass of solids, liquids, and gases as electromagnetic play. And what he's talking about is actually dark matter, which is the glue, the cosmic glue that holds everything together, rapidly spinning galaxies and controlling the rate at which the universe expands. And this plasma in the field of quantum physics is made up of 25% black energy and 65% dark matter. So black matter, which is called 90% dark matter, because scientists say that they can see only 10% of the visible universe. So that means they can only see the sun, moon, and stars, and the asteroids, meteorites, or whatever else, and that's it. Everything else is composed of this dark substance, dark matter. As we say, external DNA. Or exoteric melanin. The ancient Tamarians or Tibetans, the Egyptians, the word for melanin was kinway. The word melanin itself, of course, is Greek. And melanin basically means black substance within the Greek. If you get this article by New York Times, March 2000, this article in which they're talking about a float in a cosmic hall of mirrors reveals that the scientists have found alien matter in dark matter and otherworldly dark matter. Some scientists speculate that the mirror matter is trapped in another dimension, stuck inside what amounts to a parallel universe. In other words, scientists rediscovered black matter in the Milky Way galaxy, which was considered an alien life force or extraterrestrial or extraterrestrial astral energy in the subtle atomic realm. This is what they found, according to the article. All right. Like you said, this information is heavy within the Theosophical Society and the Anthroposophical Society, which was formed by Amanda Blavatsky and also by Rudolf Steiner. Alex Bailey states in her book, The Light of the Soul, on the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, that the Akashic Record is like an immense photographic film, registering all the desires and the earth experience on our planet. Those who perceive it will see pictures thereon, the life experience of every human being since time began, the reactions to the experience of the entire animal kingdom, the aggressions of the thought forms of a cosmic or karmic nature based on desire of every human unit throughout time. Herein lies the great deception on the records. Only a trained occultist can distinguish between actual experience and those astral pictures created by imagination or keen desire. Like, for example, like we were just talking about with my first cousin, Tim Warren, how he was, how I was pulled out of my body by the journey with the entity. Actually, it was one of my ancestors who wanted me to see Tim graduate, or was my higher self, wanted to see him graduate from a dead relative to a living ancestral state. And Rudolf Steiner writes in his book, The Akashic Records in 1902, he writes basically that that when he investigated the Akashic Records, there's the reports of instance, you know, of Atlantis, Lemuria, the evolution of man and the earth, etc. In the Law of One book, a book purported to contain conversations with a channel social memory complex known to human as Ra. With the questioner asked where Edgar Cayce received this information, and the answer received was, we have explained before that the intelligent infinity is brought into intelligent energy from the eighth density or octave. The one sound vibration complex called Edgar used this gateway to view the present, which is not the continuum you experience, but the potential social memory complex of this planetary sphere. The term you people are used for this is the Akashic Records, or the Hall of Records. And that's what it basically breaks down to. And the reason why we can tap into this is because, like we said, this Ra is talking about this prana or chi or ki energy, right? Within Gnosticism, is called the Holy Spirit, or later Christianity, that's what it was called. All right? Scientists have documented that the photonic energy of the average human is emitted at the equivalent of a 120-watt light bulb, or 120-volt battery, or 25,000 BTUs. But that our auric sphere, or astral star body, the higher astral body, spiritual body, is eternal, and is equivalent to the lifetime of the universe, which is about 10 E, 22 years. So the astral field contains the electromagnetic or the electronic mass of 4 E, 21, which is 4 and then 21 zeros, at the end of electrons. So that's how you're able to survive death, is because, based on what we just been talking about, how your auric cell is able to be emitted with 10E22, which is actually the lifetime of the universe. So it's 10 plus 22 zeros after it.
Okay.
Now, you're going to go to the phone lines and see what's up. You got area code 609. Area code 609, you're on the line.
Peace, Dr. Irene. Peace.
Hello? 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 Can you hear me? Dr. Ali?
Y'all able to hear me out there? Hit me up on the chat room, y'all, if y'all can hear me. All right. So y'all can hear me, then I don't know why the brother can't hear me. So we're going to try it one more time here. 609, area code 609, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Peace, man. I'm calling from the Virgin Islands, man. How you doing?
All right, doing good.
I got a question about, well, not really a question, but just I just wanted to let you know about a type of new moon ritual I've been performing for the last 6 to 8 months, and just wanted your insight on, because it's just something I incorporated using my wife's menstrual blood. And on a new moon, I've been harvesting her blood every time she has a menstrual cycle in a glass container. And on a new moon night, I would write down some evocation phrases, starting off by saying, I, the man, Alexander, you know, my name. And I'd say, like, you know, I want to evoke health, protection, stuff like that. On a 3x5 card with a lead pencil, number 2 pencil, I would go out into the yard by a tree, dig a hole, read the evocation words on the 3x5 card, burn it, let the ashes go into the hole, and then pour my wife's blood on it and bury it by the tree. I've been doing that every new moon for about 8-9 months now. You got any insight on that particular type of ritual?
What have you experienced? Have you experienced the help and the protection that you've been wanting?
I've been experiencing a lot of what I've been writing down on my cards, except that it was tragic that February of this year, the company closed down after 40 years. So, you know, I'm at a transition stage right now where I'm looking to work in my field. But other than that, I mean, everything that I've been doing, I feel, have been, you know, working in my favor.
All right. Now, when you use the mystery blood of your wife, of course, you know, when y'all come together, I mean, that's a powerful force within itself. And then the force in which that flows from her, in which that has mitochondrial DNA, in which that symbolizes Khnum, who is the creator god of the Ba and the Ka on the potter's wheel, that is what is being actually utilized and actually to invoke the help and the protection is actually the Netter Khnum. Within the Sanskrit teaching is known as the Oja. the college.
Mm-hmm.
You know, okay. But within the Kemetic teachings is actually is Kanun and Nephet.
Mm-hmm.
Right? In which that formed the Ba Naka, which is the Kaaba, or your spiritual soul. Right? So
okay.
That is what you're doing, is tapping back into that particular essence of yourself, because remember, within the womb of the woman is the formation of the life principle itself. She's the molder, the shaper of life. You know, she symbolizes the 13th attribute of Allah within the 99 attributes of Allah, Al-Musawwiru. You know, so I'm just giving you the different names, you know, throughout the various religions and various mystery schools, you know. So
I also like what you talked about earlier about also, you know, calling on seven generations of your ancestors, of your mother's and your father's side. I think I'm going to incorporate that into my invocation writings.
Right, exactly. You have to. You have to call on them because they're the ones in which that you are a concentration of. That is symbolic to the 14 pieces of Osiris, in which that Osiris or Osal was cut up into 14 pieces. It's symbolic to those 14 generations. Seven generations on the mother's side, seven generations on the father's side. It is also correlated to the fact that you're doing the moon rituals, in which that seven phases of the moon.
That's on the new moon, actually, right?
Right.
Okay. So you've heard about that type of ritual?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I heard about that ritual, because it's during the new moon, in which that you're able to manifest what you want, because the gateway is open, because there's nothing there in order to distract the energies.
Okay. Because I knew about the new moon type rituals, but I just incorporated my wife's menstrual blood as a part of that new moon type ritual.
Right. The people that's born
tree outside.
Right, the people that's born under the new moon are some of the most powerful people on the planet.
Yeah, I wish I knew more about my birth certificate, because where I'm from, they don't really give you time of birth and that type of stuff. And when I try to do the research on it, it's like, you know, that's before they had computers and shit. And so now they're like, it's really difficult to get that information from where I'm from.
Right. Well, you can still do dowsing. You're able to do dowsing. You are able to if you do a clock setup and do a year setup, you can actually find out the closest time to your birth, based on your birth certificate, based on your, you know, coming forth from your mother's womb. You know what I'm saying? That particular time.
That's funny, because every time I ask my mom, she's like, she can't really remember. I'm the first of three boys, and she can't really remember exactly the time. She gives me an approximation, but it's not like a definitive, like, oh, yeah, it was that time, you know?
Right.
So I'm kind of frustrated about that.
Yeah, but you can use a dowsing crystal in order to find out the approximate time. You can use
what type of crystal?
Dowsing. D-O-W-S-I-N-G. Dowsing crystal.
Okay. I'm going to look into that.
Mm-hmm. And you can use that in order to Okay.
I appreciate that, and thank you for the call.
Yeah, no doubt. Appreciate you, bro. All right, area code 512. Area code 512. You're on the line. 512.
Peace. What's going on?
Not much. What's up with you?
Everything has been going good. It's just, I just wanted to let you know. Like, it's not something I was playing around with. It's more so like, I watched a movie, and the movie acted kind of as a gateway to, it was just simple as watching a movie that just, like, kind of opened as a gateway, but I never really tried to, like, channel, say, like, Crowley or something like that. It was more so some, like, I just always been interested in basically just, like, I guess the intensity and the determination that, you know, that he had as, like, as far as going to, you know, yoga system and all that. It's never to do something right. evil or anything like that, you know.
Right. Well, let me ask this. Do you have an altar set up?
Yes.
Okay.
Call upon
your ancestors, the ones that changed your shitty diaper, the ones who love you, you know, the ones who wipe the tears from out your eyes, you know. These are the people in which that you will call because they will have the best interest for you, living or passed on. You understand what I'm saying? So when you channel, you don't want to channel something in which that is just a possibility of what might come. You're going to be able to concentrate and focus on who you are trying to bring, you know, into, you know, your sphere of thinking. You know, if you want them to simply communicate with you via your mind, they will. In African traditions, they allow for the entities to come inside of them to possess them. I don't think that's necessary because every time that I see a person do that, when they come out of it, you know, the energy is gone because the entity had to utilize some of their life force in order to attempt to do that process of the individual who's still living. So they are weak afterwards. And sometimes it takes hours or days in order for them to recuperate.
I see. Well, so, it's when I was doing those, like, pineal gland, I was doing those exercises, and it would always happen like when I was in the dark, but when it really came, cause I never really, you know, I would just have a dream or something, but I didn't understand when I was doing it. But like I told you with the Lilith thing. And then once I realized that, like, I was like, whatever that was, like, I wanted, you know, banished. Like, it wasn't necessarily the experience that I wanted.
Yeah.
More so.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, are there any, say, like, ones that you work with besides the ancestors?
That when you get to a different level. You know, I don't recommend doing that until you work with the ancestors, until you are able to develop what is called discernment of spirit, which is a gift that you receive from the Holy Spirit, which is actually from you mastering the subtle bodies. So you are able to tell different spirits, and when they come to you, who is who. But that's something that has to be developed.
Okay.
It has to be developed. And you do that through mastering Qigong or Tai Chi. Something which that gives will be able to bring universal energy down. By you mastering the universal energy, then you are easily able to distinguish between good and good and negative spirits, or positive and negative spirits. In other words, there's some spirits in which that acts as familiars or as family members.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, that would make sense. Well, it's just usually, it doesn't happen because, you know, like, I have a dog. And basically, when the dog's in the room, like, I'll never have those dreams. I'll never have those experiences or anything like that. But when she's out of the room...
That's because the dog acts as a protector.
Mm.
That's what is symbolic in ancient times. The dog is symbolic to Anpu or Anubis. The black-headed jackal. Right, the dog. And the dog is a protector. Especially from those entities in the underworld. Matter of fact, he was the lord of the underworld, in a sense, because he actually was the angel of death, Azrael within the Hebrew or Jewish text.
I see. Yeah, I mean, when it was like, I was really interested in like channeling because I wanted to just get wisdom from. You know, I mean, like, I would see, like, you know how, like Brother Panic, like, how he talked to, like, Bruce Lee and just different things. I was just kind of trying to do something like that.
Right, I understand.
No more so.
But that still has to be worked up to.
Yeah.
In other words, you just don't go into it unless you have had family members through generations. This is what we're talking about, the seven generations on your mother's side, seven generations on your father's side. If there's people within those 14 generations who have actually been doing this on the regular basis, tapping into those particular spheres, and you come out as a concentration of those 14 generations, then you will have the ability in order to do it automatically. That's what people talk about when babies are born with a veil over their eyes, and they're able to have the gift of prophecy, being able to see into the future, and those types of things.
I see.
You know, but if you don't have those particular generations working like that and doing those particular things, then you have to develop it, and then you pass it on. So if you have to reincarnate again, then you come back into a stronger bloodline. This is what these Europeans know within the so-called Illuminati. This
but we are the Illuminati, right? I mean,
yeah, that's why I said so-called Illuminati.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean,
I definitely see what you're saying, and I appreciate that. Because I'm more so, it's like I just really got into, I don't want to say like the dark side, just things that I didn't, that I just didn't know. And, at first, you know, I had really been embracing like the Kriya Yoga path and with Sunyata Saraswati and like studying his books. And then.
Stay on it.
And then I went into the Crowley thing, and I found that interesting. But now I'm thinking about just, you know.
But see, let me explain. The Crowley thing is based on Tantra.
Right.
But it's perverted Tantra. You know what I'm saying? I mean, he had a couple of wives that would say he drove crazy. You know what I'm saying? He was having sex with animals, allegedly, having sex with men. You know what I'm saying? Having sex with prostitutes, caught syphilis, you know, all types of things, you know, according to history. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't there, so this is still just being speculated based on what is being said. You know,
yeah, a long time ago.
Right.
But the thing that was interesting is I found, like, I mean, it was like a priest of Heru that he came into contact with, and I thought that was embracing the, you know, I mean, I thought that basically led to the same thing that we've been talking about. You see what I'm saying?
If you go and deal with that, because Pastor Beverly Randolph understood the science of between. Of sex magic between man and woman.
Yeah. Oh, you know? No, I mean, definitely.
Right. And didn't pervert the teaching. And didn't recommend the perversion of the teaching. That's something in which that Aleister Crowley did on his own. Thinking that he was a super adept, but yet, allegedly, he died with, died of heroin abuse. You know, with more heroin in them, you know, then they say, you know, of 10 men, set up with more heroin than, you know, could have been within 10 men.
Yeah.
And that's how he died, allegedly. A heroin.
But what? Yeah. Well, the thing was, well, it's because my friend, like, she's a good person. You know, I mean, she has had some weird experiences, but according to her, because her last name is Crowley, like, that's her great-uncle. And, like, she mm-hmm. says, he was not a kind or understanding man. And, like, I can understand that, but what I was saying is, because he was going back to Kemet, I mean, don't you feel like he was trying to do some of the same...
Yeah, but I mean, was it out of help for others, or was it out of, you know, ego for himself? Was he trying to gain power for himself, or was he doing it in order to help others? There's a difference.
Well, I'm pretty sure he was trying to do it for himself.
Yeah, based on what she told you, I would gather that. So
yeah.
why would I even deal with someone like that? Because they would still be the same selfish ass motherfucker outside of the physical as they were inside the physical.
Yeah. No, I definitely see what you mean.
Yeah.
It's just when I got into the information when I was younger, it just seemed, I guess it was just more so, it was just like the determination and just how, you know, excelling, you know, in spirituality, in the yoga system and all that.
Right.
I think that's more so.
I've read Aleister Crowley stuff over the last 25 years, you know, ever since I was like 20 years old. And truthfully, not impressed. And the reason why I'm not impressed is because I understood that he perverted the teaching.
And yeah, I mean, I'm not happy with that.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm all for, you know, I mean, doing what you will. I mean, as long as it harms none.
Right, and that's the key. I mean, that was a true statement. You know, I mean, shoot, that's the United States Supreme Court case. Law decisions in which that states that man is outside of the law, you know, of governments in which that he helped form, and therefore outside of the government, you know, in the sense of, you know, law in that particular regard, you know, without his consent, you know, in which that was formed and structured by men. You know, so basically, yeah, it goes back to do what thou will, but harm none.
But harm none, okay. Yeah, exactly.
Right, but he did harm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And that's why you were saying.
Yeah, he drove his wives to the damn mental, you know, mental really damage.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Yeah.
By trying to teach them and make them tap into things in which they wasn't ready for, with no proper development.
And he felt he was a god.
Yeah. But I mean,
and I'm sure maybe that's where his soul was, but maybe not necessarily, you know, his mind.
Well, let me state this, is that everyone in which that is living on planet Earth do not necessarily have a soul. Now, every person living have a spirit. But a soul is something in which that has been developed over eons. But there are people on this planet who has not yet developed a soul because they are new spirits in which that have come into incarnation and have no soul whatsoever. And therefore, they show no sympathy or they show no empathy. They show no remorse. They show no guilt. And they are still, and as a matter of fact, we would classify them as sociopaths or psychopaths.
Mm.
You know, so when a young spirit try to get into ancient knowledge, you know, in that regard, I think it's detrimental. And I think Crowley is one of those new spirits trying to become a god, but yet didn't have the proper training. Because if he would have, then he would have followed the road of higher or high magic instead of low magic. Because everything in which that I've seen based on my readings of him was based on low magic and not high magic. As you made mention of earlier, there's a difference. High magic is worth cultivating self outside
right.
of the ego and personality, while the lowest magic or low magic is worth cultivating the ego, you know, and trying to manifest what you want into manifestation. So he was dealing with low magic. He wasn't dealing with high magic. You know, even though the end goal is the one, ultimately, if you keep practicing.
Yeah, well, his biggest accomplishment was contacting AWOS or, yeah, something.
Right, right, AWOS, like the Book of Law. And AWOS was this big-headed, you know, gray-looking, quote-unquote, being, but it was nothing more than a form of Heru, a Horus. And, of course, we know that Heru did not look like a gray. So that was the perception that he's picking up based on, you know, him also, you know, understanding, you know, or seeing those particular creatures or beings on the first and second overtone level, as we mentioned out. We did say that those greys and reptilians and elves and all these different creatures in which they conjured up within our minds or have contacted us through interdimensional travel or whatever the case may be, this is where they dwell at. It's on the first and second overtone level of the astral plane. But
that's where the fairies are at.
Yeah, the fairies, elves, smurfs, every damn thing that you have imagined or have seen. Of course, everything that we have imagined or have seen via TV or movies actually exists now on the first and second overtone level of the astral plane. Because now it's become embedded within the collective minds of humanity, of mankind.
I was going to say because, I mean, there's certain deities, you know, for protection. I would say, is Anubis or Bas,
Bas or Bas, right, is the deity for protection.
Because I'll always run into cats when I walk outside. Mm-hmm. You know, that's been happening since I was little.
Right, that's Bosset. Right. She can be Bosset is the genital form of Sekhmet. Who is the venture for Ra.
And I mean that would be something good to call on, because yeah, I mean it was more so just movies, and I had like a couple drawings that I had, but I put those away because you know, I'd have weird phenomena when I was sleeping.
Well, let me explain. Once again, these beings do not physically exist. These are thought forms. And these thought forms are, we have used symbolically to mean certain aspects of our physical body. So, for example, like Tahuti symbolizes the medulla oblongata, which is at the back of the head. Okay. Heru symbolizes the awakened soul, which is the soul embedded by the pioneer man. Or Set symbolizes the Kundalini energy as he travels up to become the queen of heaven. All right. Nebhet and Kebet, or what is known as also another form of Set, symbolizes the Ida and the Pingala, which are the sacral nerves that crisscross each other coming up out of the spinal column. All right. The 72 angels, you know, symbolizes the 72,000 nadis is stemming from the Kunta gland. All right. Those are the 72 cherubims, or negative angels. The 72 positive angels symbolize the 72,000 nadis stemming from the pineal gland, in which that 144,000 within your body. Hence, the Book of Revelation speaks about the 12 tribes of Israel and how it is made up of 144,000 people. So all of these things on which that is being seen as representative or symbolic actually are aspects of the physical body. The great red dragon mentioned in the Book of Revelation is nothing more than the Kundalini.
Yeah.
You know, the 10 crowns or horns on the beast symbolizes the 10 spears on the tree of life, which is mentioned of within the Book of Matthew as the 10 virgins. So all of this is symbolism. So when you start taking symbolism and you start forming it into a thought form and thinking that is a, you're trying to anthropomorphize this character or this thought form, then actually this is what is going on. And so by doing so, you can make that entity work for you, but it's a thought form.
Yeah, that's all I was trying to do in the beginning.
Right, but, you know, you would want to, me personally, you would want to deal with people who've been in the flesh here, because they will understand you more than a thought form or that you conjured up.
Right.
Because they've been in the flesh here, so they understand the pressures, the oppression.
Right, but, well, I was saying, I was saying boss, because, you know, basically that would, I would feel that would protect better against something, some ancient old energy from, you know, a long time ago that's been feared and, you know, all that. You see what I mean?
Yeah, I understand exactly what you mean. And yes, you can.
I would rather use that ancient.
But I just want you to understand is that it symbolizes a process or some type of organ or some type of aspect or concept within you already. And basically, the only thing you're doing is opening it up. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. No, definitely. I mean, it's all melanin. I mean, it's all just.
Right.
You know, a thought form or battery or, yeah, I mean, whatever you want to call it. Yeah.
All right, but hold on, you got more calls. Hold on. You're going to go to area code 413, area code 413, you're on the line.
Hey, y'all can hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Hey, Salim. Hey, this is Brother Teddy out in Boston.
Yeah, peace, brother.
Peace. How you doing? Yeah. Peace. I just wanted to ask you a question, right, because I was listening to the program, and I was listening to the Voodoo and stuff like that, right, and Aleister Crowley. And that brings to my question that I asked a dude, because he was talking about he do a little Voodoo and stuff like that, right? So I asked him, I said, yeah, so what about those Aleister Crowley books and, you know, Satanism books and stuff like that? Should I read those type of books to see if that's the type of magic or something if I could use? And he told me, like, nah, don't mess with it. What do you think about it?
Yeah, I mean, that goes back to what I was saying, is that Aleister Crowley perverted the teachings of the ancient mystery school.
Right.
You know, what I mean by perversion is that, you know, his teacher, who was Pastor Beverly Randolph, who was the supreme grand master of all the Rosicrucians in the world, believed
that
sex magic took place between a male and a female. Why? Because you have a transmitter and you have a conductor.
Right.
Right, or a transmitter and a receiver.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Just like a prong, you know, in a socket, you know what I'm saying? The socket symbolizes the vagina, and the prong symbolizes the phallus.
Yeah, that's the same thing that goes on, like, in computer parts. They call that.
Right. So hence you have electromagnetism. Right, you have electromagnetism.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's deep.
So the sexual act between man and woman is what produces the law of attraction, because she's the magnetic attractive force.
Right.
The woman is. You know what I'm saying? Let a woman by 10 brothers and watch. The niggas can be in deep conversation talking about all this information that you talk about and watch all of them damn have to look.
Right.
Because she's the magnetic attractive quality, yo. You know what I'm saying? And he perverted those teachings.
Right.
So I can't get with it. I'm sorry.
Right.
I've done read all his books. And there's nothing in which that correlates to the fact, you know, of that information. You know, as far as, you know, being, you know, writing is that for, you know, for us as a people. We can't utilize it in order to form a culture, you know, form a culture, Bob.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You
know?
And the word voodoo or voodoo just simply means spirit itself.
Right.
And even with that, you have to learn the science of being able to discern spirits. Because you have good ones and bad ones.
Right.
Oh,
I kind of asked him that because I was like, because he was talking about, like, I'm not sure if he was talking about Bacchanal or something like that. I'm not sure if I'm saying it right. And it's like a couple of, he gave me a book. I don't have it right now. But Yiminya.
Talking about
like
Obatala?
Well, Obatala symbolizes your crown chakra. Your head.
Right.
All right. Ori symbolizes your mind. And there's nothing more powerful than Ori, which actually is a form of Olodumare. right, which is the universal god. You have Shango, which is the thunder god, in which that the comic books within the Norse tales or mythology Thor is based on.
Right.
Then you have, Oya, in which that within the comic book, you have Storm. She's based on it from the X-Men.
Okay.
All right. You have Emiya. You have Ishualegba, in which that symbolizes Set, you know, or as we would say, the devil, which is actually nothing more than your devil or symbolic to your lower self, the flesh itself. That's why he's the Lord of the crossroads, because it symbolizes where spirit and matter meet. Hence, the formation of the cross is where matter and spirit meet. When they meet, it forms a cross. So he's the Lord of the crossroads. So this is where breath forms the physical body into existence. And what is breath? Breath is insulation and exhalation, which is what? Centripetal and centrifugal force. Push and pull. Male and female. Masculine and feminine. Agreeable, disagreeable.
Right.
But these forces are known as polarity.
Right.
Two extremes of the same pole.
Right.
So this is what this is. You know what I'm saying? So those are known as the seven African spirits. And those seven African spirits or seven African powers symbolizes the seven chakras or the seven Elohims or the seven eyes of God or the seven eyes of Ra or what is seven souls of Ra, known as the seven seals, known as the seven churches. All of that is mentioned in the book of Revelation.
Right. Or the seven Dragon Balls.
Or the seven Dragon Balls. And Goku, you know, always looking for him.
Right. And it's kind of weird because Naka, like what you just said, like match that to like other things that seem like it has nothing to do with it, but it kind of is the same. Like you were saying, you know, about the Tahuti meaning, you know, the mind and the thought and the piece of the body part. So that's like running like mad stuff.
Right.
If we was taught that.
Right.
That'd be a bomb.
Yeah, well, that's why it's not taught in school and won't be taught in school unless we put our own schools together and begin to start teaching, because that is actually what these cultures were designed for, was for us to understand how these particular symbols correlated back to the human body. It wasn't too, it was not to anthropomorphize these characters and worship them as something external of ourselves.
Right.
And that's the problem. That's the problem that I have with any religion, because they always try to make it external of yourself. Or you have to go talk to the spirits or talk to God or talk to Jesus. You know, this shit is something outside of us. And so we have a motherfucker looking upside, you know, looking up into the sky some damn way.
Right. I said that to somebody, a couple of, you know, friends yesterday, because they said they go to church and stuff. And I said, well, and actually I said that to a guy that was at this place, inside of like a kind of a called Holy Church. Say it again, bro.
No, I'm just saying that there's nothing wrong with looking outside of yourself if you understand the correlation as within, so without.
Right, and I was just explaining that this was like an AA meeting, I'm assuming, and the guy was saying, you know, well, you know, book, and I said, well, you need to learn about yourself, because I guess that's what's a lot of problems, why a lot of people are using drugs, is because they don't know about themselves. He was like, nah, go back to the book. Learn the book. And I was like, well, if you don't know yourself, then you wouldn't know what a book was telling you neither. And he just started rambling. I just got up and walked out. If you teach that to people, you teach what I call negative knowledge or false knowledge.
Hold on. We're getting ready to bring in some others here. You got area code 412. Area code 412, you're on the line.
Peace.
Hey,
what's going on? I'm Larry from Pittsburgh. I've been listening to you, doctor, for like about 2 months now. I found you on YouTube through this cat named 5thDB, and I just like to say, like, acknowledgement for real, man. It's deep. You got me like digging in books again, man. So, you know, I just want to thank you for that, you know. But You know, I was calling I've been having like dreams lately, right? They're like nothing spectacular. Like in these dreams, everything is like deep in color. You know, it's like okay, like colors are like red, you know, they're like deep blues,
Right. Brother?
Still on?
I don't know. Sound like he faded out, didn't he?
Right.
Yeah.
Sound like he faded out.
Yeah. You don't go to area code 816. Area code 816, you on the line.
Hey, peace.
Brother, I'm going to go and answer the brother. He was saying that he was seeing colors. And those colors that he's seeing are actually chakra colors. The red symbolizes the base or root chakra. If he's seen orange, that symbolizes the navel chakra. Yellow symbolizes the solar plexus. Yeah, we here, brother. Yeah, you faded out. So I'm telling you what those colors actually mean. The red symbolizes the root chakra, known as the base chakra. Orange symbolizes the navel chakra. Yellow symbolizes the solar plexus. Green symbolizes the heart chakra. Blue symbolizes the throat chakra, and indigo symbolizes the third eye, and purple, gold, and white symbolizes the crown chakra.
Okay.
So colors in which that you see symbolizes the activation of certain chakras or endocrine glands that just will producing hormones within your body. So it's being registered in your mind as colors. You're seeing these particular colors. This is what it focuses on as far as what is being activated within you. So you say you're seeing reds and blues and so forth and so on. That's what that symbolizes.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. All right, brother. 816, you ready?
Yeah. See, first, you know, I enjoy you dropping the jewels to the folks. Me and the queen, we stay listening to you and all the G body. So, you know, we do want to say peace for that out here in King Cypher in Kansas City. So first off, peace for that. And I got a couple of things. First, like, what is a beginning exercise activating so far as activating your seventh chakra? Like, what would you advise to start off on?
Right. Well, the first chakra that you would want to activate is your third eye. All right, which actually gives seven eyes, ranging from out from in between the eyebrows all the way up to the forehead, which is the hairline. So you can activate those particular eyes, in particular the one up near the forehead, what is known as the hairline, is the one that you really want to activate and work with. And that one will act as a step-down transformer of energy to the rest of the seven eyes of Allah, as it is referred to as. So you want to activate that, and what you can do is actually, like, take a penny, wet it, and then just put it at the hairline area, or right below the hairline area, in the middle of your forehead, and focus your energy there. And by focusing your energy, that will actually activate and open that particular chakra.
Word. Yeah, and I want to get at you because I need to, get my nationality card and all my sovereignty business taken care of. You know, I've been on it for a minute, but now it's time to go on and wrap that up. How do I get in touch with you so far as that?
Give me a call at 252-257-3588. 252-257-3588.
Yeah, when's a good time to reach you?
Anytime. You can call me after the show or even tomorrow.
Yeah, no, I'm going to call you a little later on after the show.
Okay.
All right, good looking, brother. Peace, God.
All right, peace. All right, brother Mike, area code 413, your brother still on?
Yeah.
All right. Anything else y'all want to discuss before we get off of here?
I mean, I think it was a really good topic, Aleem. kind of funny how it came.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I wanted to do you. You know the lesser banishing ritual, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Rosicrucian. Golden Dawn, mm-hmm. Rosicrucian. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I basically just use that just for banishing protection.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's the reason I use that one, and that one has really seemed to help as far as getting those, I guess you could call them familiars. I'm not really sure, because I had a girlfriend before that had experiences
right.
like that.
It's supposed to get rid of negative spirits, exactly. Hold on, we're going to go to area code 36. Hold on, 336, area code 336.
Hey, what's going on,
Peace.
Brother Lane? This is Robert.
All right.
From, Greensboro.
Peace. All right.
Yeah, I just wanted to know about, how to properly set up an altar. But when I do, I had this particular incident that happened with my son, with my little 9-month-old son. He had problems breathing one morning. And I had to sit down, and I put my hand on his chest. And I always call on my big mom, that's on my mama's side, and my grandma,
right.
that's on my father's side. And I
right.
call on them, and I called on the creator, the universe. And we ended up taking him to the doctor. And when we got there, they checked him, breathing and everything. They couldn't find out what was wrong with him. And he got better. I mean, I just wanted
that's
to share that out there with you.
That's the first. Excellent. Yeah, and how you set up an altar is you need the four basic elements, earth, air, water, and fire. And so you need, which that symbolizes the earth, like we were saying, seashells, coins, gems, or, stones, that type of thing. Water. Fire would be the lighting of the candle or the lighting of the incense. The air symbolizing, seven-day candle is mostly the ones in which that is used.
Right,
so it's
okay.
the one in which it's in glass, the tall ones in the glass.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But I know my big mom, she always liked to smoke those little slim cigarettes. And my grandma, she grew up on the farm, but she was chewing tobacco a lot back when I was younger. She's the one I had told you in the message that she's half Cherokee and Blackfoot, and my grandfather was Blackfoot. But I was wondering, should I put some of that?
Yeah, you want to put young tobacco onto the altar. That symbolizes the tobacco for them, as well as also tapping to the issue of leg by energy.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's...
Okay. And another thing too, man. From the last dream that I had, and I was telling you before, I had another one in particular. It was several months back that I was on. But it was this being, whatever, that was with me. But it was like on the dark side of the planet. But we was looking at the planet Jupiter, and it was like he was showing me different things, telling me different things about it. That's just like one of them, man. I don't have so many dreams about so many different things.
Right. Well, Jupiter symbolizes the planet of gifts and benevolence. Matter of fact, Jupiter is the closest during the time, actually during this particular time period. During the so-called Christmas, so-called holy days. And that's the reason why we have the tendency of giving gifts during this time period, because that's when Jupiter is the closer to the planet, and it symbolizes the planet of gifts. So that's no coincidence. The reason why it was set up, this particular holiday or holy day was set up during this particular time period called Christmas or Christmas, in which it actually symbolizes a form of Heru. Or the messenger, or a messiah, You know what I'm saying? Doing it at different times. But this is why they made during December 21st through 24th, you know, the, those 3 days and three nights symbolized as the time of Jesus, you know, birth. You know, so this is all correlated to, you know, what they call the people's religion, called paganism. But, of course, you know, this has now come within the various Catholicism of the Vatican, as well as also within the traditions of the Protestants.
Oh, okay.
Right.
All right.
We got another caller here. We got area code 702. Before I go, we want to get to the last call here. We want to say for those that's interested, come on out. Come on to this cruise, United Washington Cruise, March 21st through 25th. We're going to have a good time. We're going to Cozumel, to Mexico, to the pyramids. So you get a chance maybe to check out your ancestral grounds and what they built right here within the Americas, you know, because people can talk about going to Egypt, you know, but haven't even gone and seen the mounds or the pyramids that's built right here within your own backyard. So come and check us out. Give us a call at 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588. Or go to my Facebook page and see the flyer. If it's on there, you can pull it up on a profile. If not, give us a call, and we can give you all the information so you can definitely get your reservation. And now we're going to go to area code 702. You're on the line.
Brother, Dr. Lane, peace. How you doing there?
Peace out.
I got a quick question for you. As far as calling on your ancestors, do they have to be in your direct bloodline, or can they be loved ones that weren't necessarily?
They can be loved ones.
Loved ones, okay.
Yeah, they can be loved ones. Mm-hmm.
As far as their spirituality, when they walk the earth or whatever, does it necessarily, I mean, let's say if they was Christian, does that necessarily matter now that they passed on and see the truth?
No, because they'll see the truth through you.
Oh, so basically I can help them too.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. As far as Vegas, you know, they got the pyramid and the Area 51 and all that out here. What do you think about that? Is just looking at it from the outside? Is something
right,
going
right.
on with that?
Well, Area 51 is actually where they did the moon hoax simulation at. You know, when they claimed that they landed on the moon, and the simulation was actually done there on Area 51. You know.
Is that right?
Yeah. So that's
so,
actually.
I'm listening to you.
Go ahead,
so actually, it's some kind of I think it's some kind of rituals they have going on. You know, they got the Luxor out here. You know, they set it up like a casino, but I think it's more to it than that. Because inside of the Luxor, you got the magic show with the what's the magic guy's name that does all the levitation and all that.
Chris Angel.
Yeah, he got a show right there in the Luxor. So I'm looking at that like the Christ energy inside of the pyramid.
Right, exactly. That's the whole science. Exactly.
Yeah, it's something going on, but I know you got to get out of here. I just wanted to ask some things real quick.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you definitely on point, brother. And, yeah, Chris Angel, of course. Chris symbolizes the word Christ. And then Angel symbolizes the angel Michael. You know, which that he symbolizes, you know, also in that regard. And then, like you said, which is a form of Heru. Michael and Christ, or Krish, is a form of Heru. And then Heru is in Luxor, which, you know, symbolizes Waset, you know.
Exactly, yeah, yeah.
Right.
And then right up the street, they got the MGM across the street, set up like the Sphinx, you know. They got the big line in front of the whole casino, right across from the Luxor, a little up the street.
Right. Well, that was put together by, quote, Rosicrucians or whoever it may be, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, who dealt with that type of science, you know, there in Las Vegas, you know. So that's who you're dealing with. You're dealing with those who study the high mysteries, and, you know, and that's what they're utilizing is the setup of those particular structures in order to give off certain energy, you know, from those particular points or grids.
Yeah, it's definitely a higher energy. One more thing. On the side of the Luxor, they got, like, at night you can see the light shooting up into the sky, which is basically,
right.
I think that represents the third eye opening up.
Right,
but then
exactly.
On the side of the pyramid, they got lights going up and down, like, and I think that's like souls channeling up and down, represents souls channeling up and down.
Yeah, similar to the angels going up and down the spinal column, which is known within the Bible in Genesis, the 32nd chapter, I believe, 30th chapter through the 32nd chapter, somewhere in between there, where it speaks about Jacob had a dream and he's seen angels going up and down a ladder.
Oh, ladder.
So,
okay.
Becomes Jacob's ladder. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, my brother, that's all I got for you. Keep on doing your thing, man. You got a lot of powerful information. I appreciate you.
No, appreciate that. All right.
You're
getting
sir.
Ready to head out. And I'm getting ready to. Any closing remarks, Brother Mike?
Oh, I think it was a good show. No, I'm definitely looking. I'm going through massage school right now. I'm definitely looking at going down to Mexico and check out the Omex and the pyramids. I gotta start selling some of your books, yo.
Okay.
You know, because I mean, when we do, like, I learned so much in there, you know, about the human body. Like, they went into the melanin and everything, you know, of course, you know, I mean, they weren't necessarily spiritual about it, but, I mean, they broke it down. And so, but the thing is, you know, I mean, we put in so much work, give off so much energy for these people to get a massage. In the state of Texas, they don't let us accept tips.
Right.
You know. So I'm going to have to start selling some of your books.
All right. Well, definitely give us a call on that. We definitely can set that up. And we getting ready to head out.
First World Order Radio, finally. We are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence, an indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence, an indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.